Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Glebe Chapel Online. My name's Jan, and I'm introducing the service this morning. So what have you got to look forward to? Well, we the usual opportunity to sing your heart out to words and accompaniment from our musicians, and you should have received the words in an email so that you can sing along. Thanks to everybody who's made that happen. Angie has prepared something for our younger viewers, so thanks, Angie. Christine will lead us in a reflective prayer time, and thanks to Christine for that. There'll be some words from Jenny Smith too, which is lovely, and I look forward to hearing what you have to say, Jenny, and thank you for preparing that for us. And then the message is from Richard Harknett, and if I look at my notes, I can tell you that it's entitled The Very Real Truth of the Resurrection. And Richard is also leading some Bible studies with us over the next few weeks. And you should have had an email about this. And if you want to take advantage of those, then please let Jodie know so that she can send you out the link, the Zoom link, and any materials that you'll need to prepare for that. Now, it's the 3rd of May today, which is exactly 40 days since the start of our COVID lockdown, which began on the 25th of March. And 40 is an interesting number. 40 days is often associated with a period of testing and a period of challenge. And the number 40 appears in the Bible a number of times. I was able to find 7 references to the number 40. And if you're up for a challenge, why don't you see if you can find some references as well? Here's 5 hints to give you a head start of where to look. 4 of them are names of people. So there's Jonah, Jesus, Moses and Noah, and one of them is an event. So my 5th hint is Easter. So that should give you a head start if you're up for the challenge of finding references to the number 40 in the Bible. Now, a person who lived through a time of real challenge was Habakkuk. And Habakkuk wrote a book in the Bible called Habakkuk, strangely enough. And if I can find it for you, I'm going to read from Habakkuk chapter 3, starting at verse 17. And this is what it says. Though the fig tree does not bud, though there are no grapes on the vines, and the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Saviour. The Sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to go on the heights. So, into our service. Thank you.
Hi everyone, it's Lois and Kez here. We are going to lead you in a couple of songs, so please grab your lyrics and join in as we sing This Is Amazing Grace.
Thank you. Some great weeks. Hasn't it been wonderful being able to get out into the sunshine, into the garden, if we're lucky enough to have a garden? But you know, I used to hate the rain. But since I've become a gardener, I found myself praying for rain. And God has answered my prayers, and this week it has rained. Unfortunately, it's meant that I have to be inside and do some housework and some tidying up. However, when I was tidying, I came across this box. And inside the box was Gep, my old friend. His name is Gep because it stands for Googly Eye Prism. Now the googly eyes are pretty obvious, aren't they? Can you see them? Prism, now that's a little bit more difficult. If you think of a Toblerone bar, a see-through Toblerone shape, and if a special light shines through it, it separates the light and it creates a rainbow. It's all very clever. And I think when my children named Gep, they must have been studying physics at the time. Now, ever since we've been locked in, I have seen a lot of rainbows. Because every day as I walk around the block having my daily exercise, I see pictures of rainbows in the windows of houses or on the gateposts. And I believe that the nurse who decided that the rainbow would be a good symbol for this time for the NHS said, "Rainbows make people smile and offers a message of hope." So this is my rainbow friend, my googly-eyed prism, Gep, the rainbow puppet. Oh, he wants to say something. What is it, Gep? Ah, yes. Gep says that he wants me to tell you the story of the very first rainbow. Okay, you have a sit down then, Gep? Yeah, have a sit down while I tell the story. Noah was a man found in the Bible. You can find his story in the first book of the Bible, in Genesis chapter 6, right through to chapter 9. Noah was a man who loved God. The Bible tells us that he walked with God. That means he talked to him and listened to him, and he loved him. One day, God gave Noah some special instructions to build a great big boat. Why was that? Well, God was sad because Noah was the only person in his time who did love God. Everybody else had turned their backs on God and had become violent and horrid. So God had decided in his sadness that he was going to start again. He was going to wipe out everybody and everything and start all over again, except he was going to save Noah and his family. So Noah was very trusting and obedient. God gave Noah all the dimensions and Noah set apart building his boat. The strange thing was that the boat was in the middle of the land. It was nowhere near the sea. And the people, as they watched Noah building his ark, thought he was a little bit crazy. But Noah didn't care. He knew that God had a great plan. He didn't know what it was, but he was obedient. And so eventually the ark was finished. And inside went his family, two of every animal, lots of provisions, and in they went. And God shut the door. Then the rain began. It rained and it rained for 40 long days and 40 long nights. Eventually, it stopped, and the rain and the floods began to go down. But it took an awful long time for the land eventually to be fully dry, but it did. And Noah and his family came out of the ark. Oh, Gep wants to say something. What's that, Gep? What do you want to say? Ah, yes. Gep wants me to remind you of the best part of the story. The fact that God put a rainbow in the sky. And the rainbow was a sign, a promise, that God would never ever flood the earth again. And because God is a good God, he keeps his promise. Now, my children have had fun this week making a video. Have a look at this. You can join in with the words if you know the song.
Mr. Noah built an ark. The people thought it such a lark. Mr. Noah told them so, but into the ark they would not go. Down came the rain in torrents. Down came the rain in torrents. Down came the rain in torrents. But only 8 were saved. The animals went in 2 by 2. The elephants, giraffes and kangaroos. All were safely stored away.
To rain and you can't get outside, why don't you make a video of your favourite Bible story or sing along to a favourite song of yours? You could send it to Dave Hannah and maybe it'll make the Sunday service next week. Anyway, Gep, what can we learn this week from our Bible story? I think we can learn 4 things. Firstly, it's good to walk with God, to talk with God and to listen to what he has to say. Secondly, it's good to trust God and to obey him too. Sometimes that's really hard when we're in a difficult situation, but we can ask God to help us trust him and obey him, and he will. Thirdly, did you notice in the story of Noah that God shut the door, not Noah? And that reminds us that God is in control of every situation. And fourthly, yes, Gep, fourthly, we can thank God for rainbows. And we can thank him that his promises are true, his promises of hope and love. So why not set that as a challenge for ourselves this week? Let's see if we can do all 4 of those things. Okay, Gep, shall we say goodbye then? Bye, everybody. Bye. Have a good week.
Good morning, I'm Christine. I'm going to read a poem this morning and then I'm going to pray. I'm going to show you pictures of 2 beautiful trees that remind me of spring every year. The one outside my bedroom window and the one that turns the most beautiful colour in the spring in my garden. Each time you look up in the sky or watch the clouds drifting by or feel the sunshine warm and bright, or watch the dark night turn to light, or hear the bluebirds sweetly sing, or see the winter turn to spring, or stop to pick a daffodil, or gather violets on some hill, or touch a leaf or see a tree, it's all God whispering, this is me, and I am faith and I am light, and in me there shall be no night. Father, we thank you for the beauty of creation all around us, and we thank you that spring reminds us of resurrection, new life and new beginnings. This year, Father, the virus has brought us all into a different place, but it has made us value the people who are looking after us and helping us, risking their lives to save ours. We pray for them, Lord, and we pray for all those who have lost loved ones. And Father, as we start this week, help us not to take anything for granted, but to see the joy in every little thing around us. Amen.
Thank you.
everyone. We really miss our church family, don't we, Mia?
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been asked to talk a little bit about what we've been doing in lockdown, and what we've been doing, Mia.
And there's baby lambs over there, and
we've been watching them running around, haven't we?
Yeah, over there.
Yeah.
So they are really grown up, and the lady saw the baby's lamb is got stuck in the hay, and she rescued it.
She did, yeah. What else have you been doing? So we've been chilling out in the sun, like you said, looking at the lambs. Have you been decorating anything outside?
We've been decorating taking pictures of my stones, and might be painting them.
Yeah. Okay, and have we been planting anything?
We planted my flower.
You planted some flowers, and there's some there.
Yeah, they're growing up really quick.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, and what have we been doing every morning before going for a walk or before going to Mummy's work? What have we been doing at the table with the computer?
Do some math.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's been fun.
Yeah.
Hi again. I thought I'd just share with you. I've been asked to share with you sort of what I've been up to, or what we've been up to during lockdown, and it was either that or my testimony, and I've shared my testimony before, so I thought I'd just share with you what I'm learning through lockdown with a six-year-old. Okay, so I asked myself, what have I been worrying about? And if I'm honest, money and homeschooling, teaching a six-year-old from home. I'm no teacher, so I've been trying to get as many tips as possible. So I've been really worrying about these things. So I looked for in the Bible at verses which are quite encouraging if you're worrying. So in Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, it says, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life?" And how true is that? You just look around. I mean, at the moment, the bird song is really loud, and I noticed in a lot of videos last week on this last week's service, the outdoor videos, the noise of the birds was amazing. Got a child in the background. So what have I learned? To slow down. I've learned to slow down. We're a very busy family, but it is a real struggle to force myself to. It's fine to be quiet. It's fine to not have anything to do. But I do kind of feel guilty sometimes. I feel as though I should be doing something. To make the most of this time with Mia, because normally she'd be lost to school. There she is. To appreciate the small stuff. Okay? The small bits. The stuff that we take for granted. Patience. Yes. With a six-year-old. I know I've only got one, but yes, it takes a lot of patience. It's a difficult lesson to learn. If you ask God for patience, be careful. Expect big lessons if you ask God for patience. I've made that mistake. Refocus on Jesus. To just refocus on what's important. What is the important thing? I read the UCB magazine most days, and it was back on Tuesday, I think it was the 21st, and it was headed "The Most Important Thing," and the verse that it came with was in 1 John, thanks Mia, 1 John chapter 2 verses 15-17. "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever. So that was, yeah, it just helped me to sort of refocus where I'm looking, to look up rather than to look around. Yeah, and so things like money, worrying about whether I'm teaching her the right way or if I'm doing enough at home with her. You know what I mean? It's not important to stop worrying, because if you're worrying, you're not trusting God to get you through it. Yeah, so worrying as well, it's a waste of time. I keep a journal to try and help me with these things, and I've really found that it helps, because if you then you write down what you're worrying about and you write down what you think God's telling you, and then you look back at it after about a month or so, look back, and you can actually think, okay, I was worrying about that, and I can see how God has got me through it. And it's really, really encouraging. If you don't keep a journal, I really recommend that you do. So yeah, referring back to that passage in Matthew chapter 6, where it says about, you should just look at the birds. At the moment, the birds are so loud. You know, when you hear the bird song, just think, okay, they're not worried. They know that God provides for them. So why are you worrying? So that's really helped me. Yeah. So those are the things that I've learned. I'm sorry I've rushed a bit. I did a video before and I gabbled on and it took ages, so I've had to re-record it. Tonight I'm going to record Mia saying a prayer, so I hope you enjoy it. I'm not sure what's going to come out of her mouth, but it was lovely to do this, and I'm really enjoying the church services, hearing and seeing people that we haven't seen for ages. So I hope you're all staying safe. And I can't wait for the services to start back up again soon. Thank you.
Hi, God. Thank you for making this whole world, and you are the amazingest boy in the whole world. And we only know so we can. And please help us to fight this bugger and keep up use soap and water to wash our hands properly, and then go and so we need to go and do two people's. It's really sad we have to get away from school, and my mummy's gonna do a bit about all the children and when she plays again. And bye.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm Hello. I hope you're managing to cope with this situation that we find ourselves in. Obviously, I'd hoped to be with you there today in person when we originally fixed this date. But then I guess all of us had hoped to be there in person at this point in time. Today is the last of your series on the resurrection, which when I heard about it, I thought was a great idea. Too often, I think we celebrate Easter and then bounce straight on with whatever series we happen to be studying or move into something new. And so stopping to think a bit more about what happened and taking some time to reflect on the resurrection seems to me a great idea. And the verses I want us to think about this morning from 1 Corinthians 15 are written by someone who I think has certainly spent time reflecting on the importance of the resurrection. And when Paul writes, he tries to set out a solid defence of what he believes. And I think his logic still stands true today. I've been a Christian most of my life, but that isn't to say that I've never had my doubts or had periods when I've wrestled with my faith. I certainly have. Sometimes it's been a bigger struggle than others. And at times in my life, I've had to defend my beliefs in situations or contexts which weren't friendly to faith in Jesus. And the more I go through those periods of struggle or doubt or challenge, I think the more and more I come back to the resurrection and all that Paul writes here. For me, I think there is simply no other way to explain what happened at that first Easter. And if Jesus really did come back from the dead, then that is sufficient foundation to build everything else on. And as a Christian, the more I read and learn, the more I tend to feel there's still so much more to understand about God and faith and life. And I've become more and more aware of the extent to which I don't know things rather than what I do know. And that again draws me back to the resurrection and that idea that I do know this, that Jesus died for me, he was buried, and he was raised again. And I think Paul wants all of us to be sure of those facts. And so he presents us with some really solid evidence to justify those beliefs. So let's read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we'll start in verse 3 and read down to verse 8. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 3. I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as the scriptures said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scriptures said. He was seen by Peter and then by the 12. And after that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Last of all, as though I had been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. Now, there is so much detail here which should encourage us as to the real historical event which took place those years ago. Just to pick out some of the key ideas that we see in this passage. In verse 3, Paul affirms that Christ died. He didn't simply pass out from the pain on the cross before later recovering. He genuinely, physically died. In verse 4, he was buried. After having died, Jesus was buried. The disciples didn't steal the body and take it off somewhere else. The women didn't go to the wrong tomb on Easter morning. That would have been the easiest to refute. They could just produce the Jewish authorities could just produce the real body. No, Jesus died and he was buried in a tomb which people knew about and could locate. Verse 4, he was raised from the dead. Death did not have power over Jesus. Verses 5 and 6, he appeared. Not just a ghost or an apparition, he genuinely physically appeared to them. He appeared to Peter, one of the closest people to him, someone who would have known if this really was Jesus or not. He appeared to the 12. He showed them his scars. He ate fish in front of them to show them that he was real and physical. He appeared to 500 at one time. And Paul almost deliberately challenges his readers here when he says, most of whom are still alive. That is to say, if you don't believe me, then go and talk to some of them. There are witnesses to this who can testify and who are still alive. You can almost put that in a kind of modern context, and it's almost as if Paul is saying, there are people who saw this. I'll give you their phone numbers if you want. Ring them and ask them yourself. And then lastly, maybe the most powerful argument that Paul presents as two people that he mentions in verses 7 and 8. Paul says, he appeared to James and to me. Now that is important because these are two people who were not disciples of Jesus when he was alive on earth in his period of ministry in those 3 years before the cross. So these aren't people who are confused by their sadness or who are wishing for Jesus to come back from the dead. This isn't someone they've been following for the last 3 years. These are people who never followed him in that period, but who after the resurrection changed the whole direction of their lives to follow him. These were skeptics who admitted they were wrong. Now, why would they do that? What would make them change so radically the direction of their life? Well, simply, as Paul says, the resurrection. Paul wants us to know and be convinced about this. The resurrection was a real historical event. Jesus defeated death and returned in a real physical body. And if that is true, then our beliefs aren't just subjective opinion or rumour. They're rooted in genuine historical events. And that gives a solid foundation to our faith on which we can build. But there is another strand to Paul's writing here in this chapter, in 1 Corinthians 15. Paul isn't just concerned for defending what has passed. He also has one eye on the future. Because for Paul, this teaching on the resurrection is important, not just because Jesus was resurrected, but because also, as a consequence, every Christian will also take part in a resurrection in some way or another. So to pass down further in that chapter, down to verse 42, 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 42. It is the same way with the resurrection of the dead. Our earthly bodies are planted in the ground when we die, but they will be raised to live forever. Our bodies are buried in brokenness, but they will be raised in glory. They are buried in weakness, but they will be raised in strength. They are buried as natural human bodies, but they will be raised as spiritual bodies. For just as there are natural bodies, there are also spiritual bodies. The scriptures tell us the first man, Adam, became a living person, but the last Adam, that is Christ, is a life-giving spirit. I was thinking the other day that one of the things that I'm hearing more and more of in the last couple of weeks is the way in which the lockdowns which are taking place across the world can have some positive effects beyond just flattening the curve of the virus. This isn't always the case. For many, this has been a stressful time and will continue to be. But in some cases, there are some positives. I was looking at your Sunday event last week and saw David mention some in his lakeside conversation with Rupert. Nature has bounced back incredibly at times. People are spending time as a family in the way they hadn't been before. I look at what's happening here where we are, and at times we're seeing a community spirit in the area that hasn't been seen for ages as we understand it. And so we're starting to reflect on that, maybe as a country. We don't have to exit lockdown and return to the same life that we had before. We want to move on to something new and improved. There's a chance here to learn from lockdown and maybe finish this whole thing better off than we started. Now, that's not to say this is the case for everyone. Some will leave lockdown mourning loss and the absence of loved ones with whom they entered this period. But for others, maybe there is the hope that somehow our lives can be similar but better, similar to the ones with which we entered this period, but now improved and better as a result of that experience. And I think Paul holds out that kind of idea to us in this passage. When he speaks about the resurrection that we will participate in, he's speaking about something that will be a life that will be somehow similar to now, but better, so much better. And the source of that, the reason for that, is the resurrection of Jesus. There's a sense in which Jesus' resurrection was no ordinary resurrection, if such a thing as an ordinary resurrection exists. What I mean is, there were various people through the course of the Bible who resurrected, perhaps the most famous being Lazarus. But there's one significant difference between them and Jesus. They all died again afterwards. Each came back to life, but to the same kind of life that they had left when they died. Jesus, however, came back to a new life. Not simply a return to more of the same, but a genuine new life in which death, suffering and pain no longer have any part. I wonder if that's part of the reason why pain and suffering and hurt so much now. Many writers have made that same observation. Why do the tragedies of life hurt so much? Why does the death of a loved one cause us so much pain? Many reasons, but I wonder if in part it's because there is something within each of us that recognises that life should not be that way, that death isn't an invader, death is an alien. Pain and suffering are not right. Life should be more than that. And there's a sense in which the resurrection proves that these feelings are correct. God has acted now to bring about the life that we instinctively know should exist. It's been said that as a consequence of the resurrection, whilst death is still a tragedy, it's no longer the great enemy. Paul makes that same point at the end of this chapter. There is something more and there is something better. And that change of perspective is something that we all need, and we can and should have confidence in God's plan. The resurrection of Jesus can bring hope and purpose to our lives because it reminds us that God knows what he is doing, both with our lives and with the world he has created. He is bringing both to the conclusion that he desires, a new life on a new earth. And that is a physical, embodied future without social distancing or viruses. And a new earth needs a new body appropriate for that. That's what Paul's getting at here in those verses that we read. Our new future bodies will be like Jesus' body, in some way like our present ones, but better, so much better. And Paul calls them here spiritual bodies as opposed to natural bodies. Now, he's not there trying to say that they'll be spiritual in the sense that they might be ghostly or somehow a physical hand would pass straight through them. What he's referring to is more what energizes and what gives life to that body. There's a natural life that we have now. It's suited to the earth on which we live and the lives which we live, but it's a frail and weak body that we have. Instead, what energizes our new bodies is a spiritual life and power which comes from Jesus. And that results in a body which is perfectly suited to the world to come and has none of the weaknesses or frailties of our present bodies. And knowing about our future in that way should change, or has the potential to change, our perspective in the present. As I was preparing this talk yesterday, I had to break off from some study to help with some first aid. Lucas and Emily had been up to the park with Pam for their daily exercise. On the way back, Emily had come off her scooter and gone splat on the path, and she reached back to our house with cuts and grazes all up her hands and her leg and her knees, and her hands were covered in dirt, and so Pam and I had to take turns in trying to calm Emily down and to clean out all the dirt and the mud from her grazes. And you know how much grazes can sting sometimes. They may not be deep, but you can't ignore them. And so Emily's not enjoying this at all, and she's crying and we're wiping. And in the middle of all this, Emily says to Pam and I, "I wish I had my heaven body so I didn't feel any pain like this." Which struck me as the context of what I'd just been doing. She may only be 9, but she has got the idea that even in the midst of pain or challenge or difficulty, there is something more and better waiting for us. Even the trials that we go through point us towards a life in which those will no longer be a part. That there is something better, there is something more. This life isn't all there is, and there is something much greater to look forward to. And what gives us the certainty of that confidence? Jesus' resurrection, the historical event that Paul offered all that evidence for. But because Jesus was resurrected, because we can be certain and confident in that fact, we can also be certain and confident in the fact that we too will be resurrected. And just as Jesus came back from the dead with a real physical body, so we too can know that we will be transformed and receive a real physical body. And that can offer us hope, even in challenging times of disease and social distancing and all the challenges that come with the lives that we're trying to live now. We have a hope that there is something better and greater waiting for us in the future. We look back to the past and see the historical fact of Jesus' resurrection, and that signposts us to the future that awaits us all. May God encourage us with what Paul is trying to do for us in here in this chapter, in 1 Corinthians 15. May God bless you all. Amen.
Thank you for the cross, Lord.